we've made the environmental commitment to drill and produce oil fields. And so I think we also need to make the commitment to get as much out of those fields as we can.
And one of the opportunities for that clearly would be the Bell Creek field in Montana.
Our primary focus is to buy old oil fields, flood them with carbon dioxide, and recover additional oil.
You're taking CO2 that would have otherwise been emitted to the atmosphere, and you're storing it underground. And that process yields a lower carbon footprint.
People don't understand how advanced carbon capture and storage technology is. People think that carbon capture and storage is a future technology. It's not. It's a present technology that we understand pretty well.
Funding provided by the U.S. Department of Energy's Office of Fossil Energy, the National Energy Technology Laboratory, members of the Energy and Environmental Research Center's Plains CO2 Reduction Partnership, and the members of Prairie Public.
Coal, oil, natural gas. We depend on these fossil fuels to heat our homes, make our electricity, and run our vehicles. But these fossil fuels release greenhouse gases, including CO2. To reduce the threat of climate change, we need to reduce emissions of CO2 and other greenhouse gases. CO2 has brought the Bell Creek oil field back to life, and scientists are using the CO2-enhanced oil recovery at Bell Creek to help move us toward a low-carbon future. Southeastern Montana, 3,000 square miles and 2,000 people, open skies, grasslands, and ranching.
When Bell Creek was discovered in 1967, the economy of Powder River County was agriculture. All of a sudden, and it really was all of a sudden, within just a year, there were jobs for probably 500 or 600 people. Full-time jobs provided services to the drilling industry, building tank batteries and pipelines and whatnot.
Bell Creek was a huge boon to Montana's oil production. Within a year, it was producing a third of the oil in the state.
Bell Creek reached its peak shortly thereafter at a very large production rate. It took Montana's level of production up to almost 50 million barrels for the year 1968. But production dropped fairly quickly.
This decrease in production marked the end of the first phase of oil production at Bell Creek, primary recovery.
Primary production, where oil is produced under its own pressure or with some assistance from artificial lift like pump jacks.
On initial discovery, a lot of oil reservoirs have sufficient pressure to flow to the surface.
What we do in primary is we just deplete the pressure. Good numbers to kind of rule of thumb that. But you produce about 10 to 15% of the oil in primary phase, and then you better go in and repressure.
Secondary production, which is typically produced via water flood, where water is injected into the reservoir and drags the oil with it as the water is going towards the production well.
And so now you got to convert some of those producing wells to injector wells. You tend to bypass a lot of oil because oil and water don't mix. So you're up to 35 or 40% of the oil in place that you produced in primary plus the water flood secondary stage.
Ordinarily, fields were produced on whatever their primary drive is for many years, but in the case of Bell Creek, it was just a few short years before the water flood started. It was generally successful for a period of time, but one of the difficulties with the Bell Creek field is water will move through the high permeability areas very quickly without ever touching the low permeability area, so it leaves a lot of oil behind. It became fairly apparent that something needed to be done to modify the water flood to try and contact more of the oil that was being left behind.
While the oil boom was winding down at Bell Creek, oil producers in West Texas were learning how to keep oil coming to the surface once production with water injection was on the wane.
And the industry really got its start in the 70s with two large-scale experiments. We're trying to change the properties of the oil so it's more mobile in the reservoir. Neither primary production or secondary did that. That's what's unique about the CO2 is that it does that very effectively.
Oil producers found that injecting carbon dioxide into the oil reservoir increased production dramatically.
The CO2 is highly soluble in oil, whereas water and oil don't mix. CO2 tends to interact with the oil and swells the oil pretty dramatically and make more of it mobile, therefore making less oil left behind than when you water flood.
The oil companies developed large geologic sources of nearly pure CO2 for their oil fields, and CO2 flooding is now standard practice in the oil fields of West Texas.
We buy CO2 from a supplier, and we put it in the ground, and over the life of that project, when we're producing the oil, we'll make some of that CO2 back. Well, CO2 is valuable to us. We want to capture it and put it back in the ground in our EOR project, and we retain CO2 in the reservoir.
CO2 EOR keeps the oil flowing in existing wells, wells that would otherwise be abandoned. By working in existing fields, oil production increases without increasing the environmental impact.
Carbon dioxide is a solution to recovering oil that would probably not otherwise be recoverable. Using just conventional technology and water flooding, you will always have a problem leaving oil behind. And I think the CO2 is a real success story.
Since the 1970s, billions of barrels of previously unattainable oil have been produced using CO2 enhanced oil recovery, or EOR. But one oil company has made CO2 EOR its business. Southeast Montana, the year 2010. Denbury acquires the rights to produce the oil in the Bell Creek field. During decades of water flooding, the field's oil production had been dwindling from over 10,000 barrels a day to just a few hundred barrels a day. But the new operator would bring a new approach to oil production in Montana.
Denbury is a very unique kind of company. Our primary focus is to buy old oil fields, flood them with carbon dioxide, and recover additional oil. Or you could say we bring old fields back to life. So quite different than the mainstream oil and gas company of today, which basically are chasing shales and fracking and drilling wells. We don't do that. We inject CO2, and that's our core strategy. And so everything we own today is either a current EOR flood or a future EOR flood or an asset that produces CO2 that, of course, we use in the process. We're centered in two regions. Gulf Coast consists of Texas, Louisiana, Mississippi, and a little bit in Alabama. In the north, we have Montana, Wyoming, and a little bit in North Dakota. We're centered around the areas where we have CO2. So to do the EOR process, you have to have available source.
The Gulf Coast source is naturally occurring geologic CO2 produced from Jackson Dome in Mississippi. In the north, the carbon dioxide comes from human activity, stripping CO2 from natural gas and helium at two gas processing plants.
Those plants are currently taking raw natural gas and processing it to pipeline quality, and they're removing the CO2, capturing it, and transporting that CO2 to the Bell Creek oil field.
We have a CO2 pipeline that comes up through the central part of Wyoming. We have another facility that we bring CO2 from. Those two pipelines come together in Natrona, and then the pipeline continues up to Bell Creek, and that is what delivers the CO2 to the field. The pipeline infrastructure is specifically designed to transport CO2. It is not a crude oil line that's converted to CO2 use. It was designed specifically to move CO2 and to transport it, and falls under the DOT regulations as many other pipelines do.
So Bell Creek is the first EOR flood that we've done in the Rockies. We've invested several hundred million dollars already. It's a big part of our future. Bell Creek is a very significant field for us in the Rockies.
Denbury acquired Bell Creek in 2010 with the acquisition of Encore. And at that time, the field was on secondary recovery, so on water flood.
Over the next 3 years, Denbury refurbished wells and existing infrastructure, added CO2 pipelines, and built gas and liquid handling facilities to rejuvenate the Bell Creek field.
We have injection wells and the associated piping with those that we take pressurized CO2 and we inject it into the ground via these injection wells.
Imagine a series of vertical wells with the center well being the injector well. And now we're going to push that CO2 out to the surrounding producer wells.
The CO2 will travel through the reservoir, displacing oil and water with it. The producing wells bring fluid to surface. From there, we actually test the wells to see how much oil, how much water, how much CO2 they're producing. That fluid is then brought to our main facility. And in that main facility, we're separating out CO2 from the oil and water.
CO2 starts to break back out into a gas when you lower the pressure. We separate the CO2, get rid of any other impurities, and re-inject the carbon dioxide and do it again. So we will usually put CO2 through the rock or flush the formation as many as 5 or 6 times before we're through.
After the CO2 is removed, the oil and water are separated.
As the water is taken off, it is re-injected back into the reservoir, and then the oil is ultimately stored when it's at pipeline specifications, then can be shipped out via pipeline.
The recycled CO2 is re-injected in combination with new CO2 from the gas plant pipeline. Eventually, nearly all of the CO2 will remain trapped in the reservoir.
The CO2 methodology is very similar to what other oil companies use. One thing that we do that's slightly different is if you look at Bell Creek, you'll notice there are no pumping units. You just see these small wellheads with small buildings around them. And that's really because most of our reservoirs are very high quality, so fluids move through them very easily. And so when we pressure them up, we can get the flow rates that we need without artificial lift.
Denbury has upgraded the existing field, removing aging tanks and pump jacks. Instead of opening new fields in new areas, Denbury is maximizing oil production in the established Bell Creek field.
By the time we started the CO2 flood in 2013, that production had declined to about 750 barrels a day, which was less than 1% of Montana's total production.
Within 3 years, Bell Creek was producing more than 5% of Montana's annual oil production, with two-thirds of development left to go.
Bell Creek is a big field, probably going to have 30, maybe more million barrels that we can recover there. It's still in the growth stage. It will continue to be a good producer.
At present projections, the EOR operation would store more than 14 million metric tons of CO2. That's equal to the average annual carbon dioxide emissions of 3 million cars.
We started CO2 injection in 2013, and we anticipate that we'll be CO2 flooding for somewhere between 15 and 20 years by the time we're finished, depending on how fast we choose to develop the field.
Denbury has revitalized the Bell Creek field using CO2 from human activities. This CO2 flood is the first step in their regional vision.
Bringing in that pipeline infrastructure allows us, of course, to then develop other fields, whether the ones we own or potentially own in the future. It gives us the umbilical cord, if you would, to allow us to develop other fields within the Rockies.
Bell Creek has captured the interest of scientists who have been looking at CO2 EOR because it permanently stores carbon dioxide. They see CO2 EOR as the first step in making carbon capture and storage a reality.
The concept of carbon capture and storage includes the capture of CO2 through an industrial process. The CO2 is then pipelined to a site that has been selected to inject the CO2 for permanent storage.
You're taking CO2 from an anthropogenic source. Anthropogenic CO2 would be emissions associated with human activities. For example, the burning of coal, oil, or natural gas, so-called fossil fuels. CO2 that would have otherwise been emitted to the atmosphere, and you're storing it underground. And that process yields a lower carbon footprint.
Carbon capture works best with large-scale stationary sources of CO2 emissions, such as coal-fired power plants, cement plants, and gas processing plants.
It's the permanent storage that we're after in carbon sequestration. CO2 EOR projects are carbon storage.
Over the life of that project, when we're producing the oil, we really store almost all that CO2. In other words, the purchased CO2 is going to stay in the ground for perpetuity, effectively.
As of 2014, there were about 136 CO2 enhanced oil recovery projects in the United States. However, almost all of them are sourcing their CO2 from a natural dome source and not an anthropogenic CO2 source. That's one thing that makes the Bell Creek CO2 enhanced oil recovery project so interesting, because it's really one of only a handful of sites right now where they're producing oil with CO2 captured from an anthropogenic source.
Because Denbury is using CO2 from human activities, the Bell Creek oil field is the site of a research project integrated with the commercial CO2 EOR operation.
The Peace Corps Partnership Program and the Regional Carbon Sequestration Partnership as a whole were developed to address climate change and find solutions to mitigate CO2 emissions to the atmosphere. The EERC, through the Peace Corps Partnership Program, is really focused on geologic storage of CO2 and developing the technologies and techniques necessary to understand where that CO2 is going in the subsurface and accounting for the amount of CO2 that is stored as a part of the normal EOR operations.
Accurate, affordable methods are needed to make carbon capture and storage practical. EOR operations at Bell Creek provide a real-world laboratory where methods can be evaluated.
The collaboration with industrial partners is key. The industrial partners bring a wealth of knowledge on how to operate enhanced oil recovery projects.
EERC is the second set of eyes from the technical aspect. They've helped with reservoir description, with how the field has performed historically, and making predictions on how it's going to perform in the future. They've also been instrumental in helping us gather some of the data, especially when it comes to the surface monitoring issues.
Denbury is focused on the enhanced oil recovery, while we're focused on understanding the CO2. Denbury gets a good idea through our research then of how much oil is being contacted and how efficient the CO2 flood is. Simultaneously, Denbury doesn't want to lose any CO2 from the system. And so the monitoring activities that we're doing is really helping Denbury better understand how their CO2 EOR project is performing.
While Denbury was working over its wells and building CO2 infrastructure, the EERC began gathering baseline water and soil gas data and learning more about the geology of the subsurface. EERC scientists also installed monitoring wells to track the flow of CO2 in the oil reservoir and note any effects on the surrounding formations.
When we conduct CO2 capture and storage, we want to make sure that the CO2 stays safely stored in the subsurface and so that it's not emitted back to the atmosphere and doesn't cause any environmental impacts.
Demonstrating that the CO2 remains trapped involves a three-part process called monitoring, verification, and accounting, or MVA.
Monitoring is the process of determining where the CO2 is going. So we use techniques to look into the subsurface or test or measure fluids coming out of the subsurface to know where the CO2 is going. Once we've injected the CO2, we want to verify that it is in the ground and that it's staying in the ground. So this is verifying then that the cap rock is sufficiently sealing the CO2 from moving vertically out of the formation, and that the CO2 isn't moving laterally out of our storage area as well. Accounting is the process of quantifying the amount of CO2 that's injected, stored, and then any amount of CO2 that's lost from the system. Ultimately, we want to know how much CO2 we keep out of the atmosphere and store in the subsurface.
It starts with the rock layers and the fluids in them.
The geology varies widely from place to place, and having a good understanding of the geology can make it easier to understand where the CO2 is going.
Scientists assemble monitoring and geological data into geologic models and reservoir simulations to improve the MVA methods.
We use modeling and simulation in our research to first build a model of the subsurface. So we collect all the geologic data that we have for the particular site, and we reconstruct what we believe the geology to be in the subsurface. And we'll target the reservoir itself and also any overlying seals so we understand the full system or storage unit. And then we'll use simulation as a way to better understand how those fluids are moving over time. Once we think we have a good handle on that, we'll predict forward using simulation to make a very good guess at what might happen. When we do that, we're able to better plan when and where to apply monitoring techniques, and also to better understand what technical subsurface risks we might have as a way of mitigating them before they even become an issue. The public really benefits for these government-industry relationships in that these technologies and techniques wouldn't be applied by industry by themselves. They're too far out in the future yet. With public funding, we're able to really advance the science.
The partnership at Bell Creek is helping scientists to learn about the behavior of CO2 in the subsurface to ensure safe, effective storage. That's good because using anthropogenic CO2 has another benefit. Enhanced oil recovery using CO2 from human activities is cleaner, greener energy.
The renewables that most people think of, wind, solar, represent worldwide only a small fraction, a couple of percent of the primary energy. 85% of primary energy in the world comes from fossil fuels, coal, petroleum, natural gas. There's a reason why oil has been the number one fuel in the world for a long, long time. It's easy to transport. The energy density is high. You can put it in a car, or you can put it in a plane. It is the workhorse for mobile platforms.
Oil represents about 30% of our total primary energy supply. And so if we don't produce oil, our standard of living is going to decrease. The two are just directly related. About 7 to 10% of the oil that's sent to refineries goes into what are called petrochemical feedstocks. And those are used to make plastics and other important materials that people need. And so if we don't produce oil, those materials won't exist.
So, the value of oil is high, but so are environmental concerns. Burning oil releases a lot of heat, and that energy moves machines and makes products. But when oil burns, the carbon and hydrogen in the oil combine with oxygen in the air to form steam and CO2. Using anthropogenic CO2 for enhanced oil recovery can help reduce the overall effect of the CO2 emissions associated with oil.
If we take CO2 from a point source, such as a power plant, we're taking CO2 that would have been emitted to the atmosphere, and instead we're transporting it to an oil field. That CO2 at the end of the project is ultimately all stored.
At the end, you're producing both products, electricity and oil, with an overall lower CO2 emissions to the atmosphere. And that's what makes it greener or lower carbon footprint.
Scientists call this green oil because its overall carbon footprint is smaller than other oil production.
Green oil has a lower carbon footprint than conventional oil.
Linking electricity generation and oil production via CO2 EOR would reduce the carbon emissions of both products, power and fuels, which would shrink the overall carbon footprint.
The source of CO2 makes a big impact on the life cycle CO2 emissions of the oil that's produced. In this case, for Bell Creek, that source is the natural gas plant. They're removing the CO2 that's present in the natural gas, preventing it from being emitted to the atmosphere, capturing it, and transporting it to the Bell Creek oil field.
So Bell Creek EOR is eliminating CO2 emissions at the gas plant by storing that CO2 deep underground.
Our economy is driven largely by electrical power, produced primarily from coal and natural gas, and a transportation sector that runs almost entirely on liquid fuel. And currently there are no suitable replacements. However, if you use a process like CO2 enhanced oil recovery to produce oil, we can reduce the overall carbon footprint of our economy.
CO2 EOR has a lot of potential. The Department of Energy did a study for EOR, and by using CO2, they estimated, I believe the midpoint in the range was around 50 billion barrels, 50 billion that could be recovered with CO2.
The big problem is where do we get the CO2? So if an industrial plant is able to capture the CO2, there definitely will be a market for that CO2 for enhanced oil recovery.
The Bell Creek oil field in eastern Montana has been brought back to life by carbon dioxide. That field is storing CO2 from human activities while producing oil, greener oil than conventional operations. And the research in this oil field is helping to develop practical methods to make carbon capture and storage an effective part of reducing our carbon footprint.
I am a believer that conservation means using the resources that you've discovered. We've already had the impact. People are familiar with the impact. We've made the environmental commitment to drill and produce oil fields. And so I think we also need to make the commitment to get as much out of those fields as we can. It's an important part of energy security. It's important to maximize the recovery of the oil we've already found.
With CO2 enhanced oil recovery projects like the Bell Creek oil field, we're finally linking the power sector and the oil sector. Right now, we're at a special time in history where we can produce oil and lower our carbon footprint.
Thank you.
Funding provided by the U.S. Department of Energy's Office of Fossil Energy, the National Energy Technology Laboratory, members of the Energy and Environmental Research Center's Plains CO2 Reduction Partnership, and the members of Prairie Public.